Good morning, everyone. Very nice. On behalf of the admissions team and Todman College, I would like to welcome you to the Architecture Preview Weekend 2019. I am very delighted to see all these happy smiley faces so bright and early in the morning. Are you all happy? Great. In the next minute, be happier. Okay? I'm Dr. Rita Ravindran and the Director of Student Affairs here at Todman College. It is my pleasure to welcome all of you and for you to understand that today is a very important day. This program is especially important as it is our opportunity to not only provide intimate insight as to who we are, but also learn more about you, each and every one of you. Today is all about you, so you can be proud cheerleaders of yourself, all right? Today, what should you do? What is this weekend about? This is what I would advise you. Ask questions and listen to answers you never thought you needed to know. Be actively present and engaged. Tell us about yourself and find yourself in your interactions with faculty, staff, and students. You will interact with faculty during lunch and at all incidental times. You will meet with students and see their work at the student studio show, open house, and you will also engage with administrators at the networking fair. As the day proceeds, we will guide you as to what is next. All right? I wish you a very wonderful and productive day today. I want you to make the best of it. Now it is my pleasure to invite Irene Huang, the Assistant Chair of Architecture. Please join me and welcome her.
Thanks, Rita. I'm going to be really quick, but I just wanted to get out in front of you guys so you could see me. I've got this awesome name tag on. So yay, architecture. We're so excited you guys are here. And we would love for you guys to just come up to us, talk to us about anything, any kind of question you have. And I would love to just welcome the dean of our school, Jonathan Massey, who's going to welcome you guys to this wonderful event.
Good morning. Thank you so much for coming to spend the day with us to learn more about Todman College and to consider whether this is the place to invest the next couple of years of your effort and your intellect and from which to launch your career. I'm Jonathan Massey, Dean and Professor here. This is my second year at Todman College. Before that, I spent many years as a faculty member at Syracuse University, where I chaired the Bachelor of Architecture program, and 3 years at California College of the Arts in San Francisco, where I was Dean of Architecture there. And the things that drew me to Todman College, I thought I'd start by sharing those and see some of that may resonate with you all. You'll hear a lot of different perspectives on what attracted people to Todman as we go through the day. I was attracted here by some of the distinctive capacities and capabilities that set Michigan apart and set Todman College apart from others in our field. One thing that attracted me was the scale of the enterprise here. With more than 100 faculty members, some of whom are part-time faculty with us, engaged in practice in Detroit, Ann Arbor, and elsewhere. Some of them are full-time faculty with distinctive careers as designers, creative practitioners, scholars, or makers. I was attracted by the breadth of expertise that large faculty brings. We have folks who are leading conversations in the field about designing for equity and factoring in health as a consideration in architecture and urbanism. We have some of the world's best digital design and fabrication faculty, and they leverage the best architectural robotics and fabrication facility in all of North America. We have all kinds of urban expertise, faculty who are urban designers, who are urban planners, and who engage with cities at the level of the buildings, housing, architecture. And we have this incredible preeminence in architectural theory and representation with faculty who are testing new approaches, particularly to what we're calling post-digital design. How do we make architecture, they're asking, in an age when algorithms make everything? When your social network is curated by Facebook and your visual sensibility is curated by Instagram, when architecture is immersed in a range of media, visual and of other kinds, that are really putting new pressures and opportunities on design. So that breadth of capacity and the ability to work with colleagues who are leading the field in so many different ways was a big factor attracting me here to Taubman College. I particularly like the conjunction of architecture with urban planning and urban design because it gives us a chance to think across multiple scales about shaping the cities and buildings of the future and to work with communities in Ann Arbor, in Detroit, in Chicago, New York, around the world to help them think big about how the built environment can better support their futures. The other thing that I have really loved about coming here is being part of one of the greatest public research universities in the US. The University of Michigan is such a powerhouse across virtually every field of research and education that if a student or a faculty member wants a collaborator who's an expert in robotics or in real estate development and business entrepreneurship, in the School of Information for data science and information expertise, or in many of the humanities and sciences fields across campus, we have those partners all around us. They help faculty do field-leading research that wouldn't be possible with just a School of Architecture and Urban Planning by itself. And students also find partners and collaborators through things like our graduate certificates in healthy cities, in urban informatics, and in real estate. So there's a real depth and breadth of capacity here. I'm going to highlight a couple of other things before I hand things over to Sharon Haar, the architecture chair, to tell us more about the architecture program and its different degrees more specifically. Among the categories of faculty leadership, we have on our faculty people like Kathy Velikov, who is chair of ACADIA, the Association for Computer-Aided Design in Architecture. This is the leading forum for people who are testing the boundaries of digital design and fabrication, machine learning and artificial intelligence, the entire repertory of technological innovation in architecture. And we have a huge faculty cohort who are active in ACADIA and in similar organizations. We also have on our faculty Kim Dowdell, who is national president of the National Organization of Minority Architects and is traveling the country, leading the conversation about diversity, equity, and inclusion in our field. We have something like a dozen winners of the Architecture League of New York Young Architects Prize, which is one of the premier talent identification awards in our field. We have faculty who work with colleagues in engineering on 3D printing concrete and digital knitting, things that are going to transform how we produce buildings in the future. And we have faculty who work with folks on the President's Carbon Commission, helping the university strategize how we're going to decarbonize for a more sustainable built environment here on campus and out in the world. And those are just a few expertise areas or hotspots. We have so much capacity here that I hope will map onto some of the diversity of paths that you're identifying for your own education and career. When I think about the built environment 10 and 20 years ago, the architecture and the urbanism that will characterize it, I think you all are going to shape that evolution. And so as you think about coming to Taubman College for your graduate education, I hope that you'll see today possibilities to cultivate your design sensibility in new directions and with a new level of virtuosity, to also develop a technological framework that will help you assimilate the rapid changes in design, fabrication, urban data, and other fields, and that you will gain the social, political, economic, and equity perspective that will help you pursue whatever mission you feel called to in terms of making a more sustainable, beautiful, and just world for future generations. With that, I think I will hand it over. Sharon, you are next, right? One more reason that I came to Michigan was to get to work with Sharon Haar, the chair of our architecture program. Sharon, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Jonathan. So over the past 2 years, I think Jonathan and I have discovered we're a rather good tag team. As he is presenting sort of the larger context of Taubman College, the architecture program in it, and our relationship to the university, I like to spend some time speaking more specifically about our curriculum, about how the curriculum and the opportunities within it manifest themselves in relationship to broader contexts like the university, the country, and globally. Also, I'm going to take this moment to mention, just before I get started, a couple of things to keep your eye out on today. Also, I will be showing you images of things that those of you who are in the room will have opportunities to see at greater length as you spend the day working with us and walking through our buildings and our studios and our exhibitions. But there are, I know, a number of people who are not able to make it to this presentation, some who are not in the country at this time or can't get out of classes or otherwise can't travel with us. So they are going to be watching this remotely or online. So I want them to be able to see a little bit more of the context as well. A couple of things just before I get started to remind you will be going on over the course of the day and to keep an eye out for. Of course, you'll have opportunities as Ritha and Irene have mentioned, to tour our studios, to meet with our students, to meet with our faculty, to hear them present. Another few highlights. We also, if you find yourself wandering around our building, not exactly sure where you are, there's always someone around to help direct you. But if you are passing by on the second floor near the program offices, there's also our gallery with our exhibition of this year's fellowship projects, done by our three architecture fellows that come in every year. And the exhibition's really fabulous, and if you need a break from the third floor studios or from the commons, it's a little bit quieter in there, a little bit more subdued, you might want to go in and check out that work. I also want to remind everyone to stay with us this evening for our incredible lecture by Shohei Shigematsu. He will be here not only for the lecture, but intermingling with us prior to that here in the Commons. And then those of you who are staying tomorrow and intend to join us for our tour of Detroit and our then drop-offs back here in Ann Arbor, but also at the Detroit Metro Airport, all the information about that is on the second page of the schedule, and so I want to call your attention to that because it's a busy day and you may forget the pickup times for that in the morning. So as I said, I'm going to spend some more time speaking specifically about our curriculum and our context. This is the design studio at Taubman, what was not yet Taubman College. But probably around the time of the founding of the architecture program, which was in 1931. The first architecture classes were taught at University of Michigan in 1867. In 1931, we became a more full-fledged program. And the first studios were taught in a building on Central Campus, now known as Lorch Hall, named after one of our very important early deans. This is what architectural education really looked like in the early 20th century, and I'll say relatively far into the 20th century itself. A lot of people with very rote replication of work. You'll notice all, at that time, male They tended towards white shirts and ties, not particularly diverse, and really what I think represented the architectural profession until fairly recently. And I like to think that we are part, Taubman College is a part of changing what the makeup and the future of that architecture profession will be. Really not only changing who we are as a student body, as a faculty, and hopefully moving forward as a profession and a discipline, but also the ways in which we go about educating students for that career and those opportunities. All architecture programs, all accredited architecture programs in the United States have to teach a certain set core material to prepare you for a career in architecture and licensure. I would argue that that material, which constitutes a fairly large part of our curriculum, is really, yes, we have to teach ultimately the same things. How we go about teaching that material and the context in which we frame it differs greatly from school to school. So it really matters where you go to school. It really matters that you find an alignment between your own beginning inklings of your ambitions for your career, not just for the first year out of school, but 5 years out, 10 years out, 15 years out, and the school that helps to prepare you for that. So you want to spend the day seeing, you know, testing us for that kind of alliance. Because in the end, that's what is most important. It's not the name of the institution or even necessarily where the institution is. It's who are your classmates, what is the context, how are we teaching you. So the core of most architectural teaching, and certainly at our school, our studio is studio life, and you'll have a really fabulous opportunity to explore that upstairs later today. This is our sequence of six studios. For those of you who have not really studied architecture in any significant way as an undergraduate and entering into our three-year program, the two core studios in there are form and situations. I'll talk about those in a moment. For those of you who are joining us, will be joining us with a Bachelor of Science degree from either Taubman College or elsewhere, the studios begin with institutions, propositions, systems, and then thesis, and again, I'll talk about them in a moment. The three-year students, after progressing through that core, will enter with next year's cohort of two-year students to continue the program very seamlessly. That three-year studio sequence is that first year form and situations is accompanied by a number of important required courses: construction, environmental systems, structure, and architectural history. Some of you may wave out of some of those classes based on classes that you've done elsewhere, but many of you will take that set of classes. They're meant to combine to provide the foundation of work that will shape the next 2 years at the school. Form is a studio that is about the sort of disciplinary underpinning of form making and formal thinking within architecture. How we think about volume, how we think about space, how we think about circulation, and the skill sets that come into play in order to do that work in representation, model making, and visualizing. The second semester studio we call situations, and situations tends to reverse the sequence we do in form, in which we first emphasize program and context and develop formal ideas around these situated environments and conditions. Then we start to move into institutions, propositions, systems, and our thesis. Those courses, the courses that accompany that are our required courses in representation and fabrication, sustainable systems, which is actually a theory of sustainability, our criticism and theory core class, integrative systems, which is an advanced course on building technologies, environmental systems, and structures in alignment with our systems studio, which I'll say a bit more about in a moment, our very important professional practice course, which Irene Huang is currently leading and transforming to align with not only how we think about professional practice here, but our interaction with professional practitioners around the and not only Ann Arbor and Detroit, but around the country, which we bring in interactive ways through virtual engagements and trips and so on. And then, as you'll see, an inordinate number of electives that are made available because we are such a large and diverse faculty. I want to take a moment to stop to also recognize that we do have people in the room who are coming to visit us for our Masters of Urban Design and our Masters of Masters of Science in Material and Digital Technology, and we will be talking a little bit about that, so I should have mentioned that before, but as I'm looking at this, I realize I've been focusing on architecture. We do have others in the room, and there will be some special breakout sessions and special activities for all of you as well, so I don't mean to make this quite so architecture-centric, so I just want to acknowledge that. The institution studio is largely about the design of a building. It is a studio in which we take on conditions of program, of context, of site, of the technologies to build that building, but more and or at least equally importantly, what does it mean for us as architects to engage with institutional structures around us? How do we rethink and perhaps react to the kinds of structures, let's say the university or the library or the town hall or 1 year the fire station, that kind of shape our encounter with the world? Each, that is a core studio, but there are 10 to 12 faculty who will teach in that studio, and each one brings to that endeavor a different perspective, a different way of approaching the overall context of that year's institution, and the students get to ballot into to choose which faculty member they want to work with. We follow the kind of coordinated studio of institutions with what we term propositions. Other schools call them option studios, but we like the word propositions because the faculty are in fact proposing to or asking or prompting a kind of idea about architecture or urbanism or about our North Campus. And that's some of, again, the variety of courses that studios that are available to you, each one taking on a different positionality relative to the discipline. And so students who are maybe, all of you who are maybe beginning to think about the scales of work you want to do or future ideas or what really interests you in the field can begin to get a taste, a sense of each of those potential directions. These are also the studios that tend to travel the most. At least 50% of all of our students at Taubman College, our graduate students, travel at one point during their experience here. And a lot of that travel is done in the proposition studios. The system studio, which starts the studio sequence of the final year, as I said, is also aligned with the integrative building systems course, focuses on housing. And for us, this is a very important studio because over the past several years and into the near term, we've been interacting with the city of Detroit to take on projects that the Detroit Department of Planning and Development are putting out RFPs, requests for proposals to developers, both nonprofit and for-profit developers and architects, for development of the city of Detroit, mostly focused, although not entirely, on medium density housing. This has been an incredible opportunity for us to both engage simultaneously in speculative work about domestic life, about the urban scale, about new ideas about construction and ways of living, and at the same time kind of activities that are happening in real life in our backyard. And we are joined over the course of the semester by Maurice Cox, who tends to introduce the studio to us at the beginning, who is the director of that department for the city, and then his staff, who come throughout the course of the semester and meet with us also in Detroit, who engage with us as well as other outsiders in the studio as it develops. And you'll see a lot of that work upstairs in the exhibition of studio work. We will be bringing next year a very large symposium to the college, also organized around the work that we've been doing with the city of Detroit and engaging, seeing how that work engages with conversations nationally and globally to sort of contextualize what we've been doing. These are just a couple of images, at least two of them from the individuals who we bring in often to interact with these, with our studios. On the top left is Michael Murphy of Mass Design Studio. One of this year's Proposition Studio is working with Mass Design Studio on a project on dealing with mass incarceration, a very important social justice issue for us. And Michael and other members of his office have been visiting with us over the course of the semester. We also have a studio partnership with Vinci Construction in Paris, France, that are working with an important young architect there, Clément Blanchet, and one of our faculty here, John O'Sturt. They are working on issues around prefabrication of architectural elements, and this is a site visit that just took place a month or so ago in Paris on one of the Vinci construction sites. Although not a studio, what you're seeing on the right is work that is being done in an elective with our faculty member Katie Newell and David Ajay, who are working on proposals interacting with prototyping facade systems. So these are just a small number of some of the individuals we also bring to the context of our Proposition Studios. Thesis is very important for us. It is not only an important opportunity for students for over a year-long process through thesis preparation and then the thesis project itself to work with directed studios and research opportunities with our faculty to kind of test not only the boundaries of the work that we are doing here, but also sort of moving forward in terms of the ideas that students are starting to bring towards their own development and their own future. And what's really exciting about the 2 days of thesis reviews is that they are also a form of celebration, and there's a rather large celebration of the work towards the end. Although I think what you're seeing in the middle there is really just a very, very large review taking place in this space. It will be it's followed by a very large party as well. But you can see it's really a culmination. It's meant to really be a celebration of the trajectory here, not just a kind of grind towards the finish. As a consequence, we really keep our students engaged very far into that very last semester. We are, I think, have some of the strongest faculty in areas of representation and visualization, partially because of some of our youngest faculty who come in through our architectural fellowships, bringing to us some of the latest thinking around how we work in terms of visualizing and representing architectural ideas. Of course, because of our facilities in digital fabrication and our sort of tradition of making fabrication, another required course is something that all of our students get their hands on. There is one required course in the digital fabrication facilities. If that is not for you, that is okay, but you get to experience it. And for those of you who are very interested in this work, there are many opportunities to pursue that work even further in studios, electives, and other classes. We have a very robust faculty in the teaching of architectural criticism and theory, led by John McMurrow, a former chair of the program, who also not only has a very robust course, but also brings speakers who can kind of engage in the discourse around our contemporary architectural theory for a really exciting conversation in his class. And as I mentioned, a required course in sustainability that deals with larger theories of the environment and ecology. We have more electives than I can name. Here are some of them. But there are over 30 of them a semester, as well as opportunities to take electives in with our colleagues in urban planning, which are sort of the electives on the right, and do coursework across the university as well with other classes that you might want to engage in other fields and disciplines that we allow you to take in for credit. We also provide a very robust cohort of technology workshops and tutorials. Many of these are offered in the evening and on the weekends that are kind of a smorgasbord for where you may yourself want to explore. Examples of that might be ZBrush or even just sort of tuning up your Excel spreadsheet capacities or GIS. But others really either done in workshops or also brought into the context of the class through our instructional technology experts. I think the key takeaway in this is that we do not teach courses in software. We utilize software within our courses. As has been previously mentioned, we have a very long history of and tradition of making in this school, known today for digital fabrication, but we also really like to get our hands dirty. I think in one of the tours you'll have an opportunity to see some of the other shops, woodworking, metal shops, and so on, that are available to students for their use, both in courses and studios. We like to get our hands dirty. Our immediate context is Michigan, Southeast Michigan, with an incredible history of making that is still really here and that the university is still very much engaged with in advanced fabrication, driverless vehicles, and so on, that many of our faculty are directly involved with. We also are really working at the cutting edge, I think, of augmented and virtual reality through our facilities over across the street in the Duderstadt Center. I think a few of you will have an opportunity to go see one of the studios operating over there, but I know that our Situation Studio always does work over there as the start of how to think through their coursework. They start with the making of a video. I'm just going to show you the beginning of one of these that they began this semester with, working with the facilities at Duderstadt. This is the moment where if you've been a little sluggish, you can sort of wake up. Okay. You'll see as well up in the student show, although it's under the in the Master of Science in Digital and Material Technology section, some of the other work that is also being done with augmented and virtual reality. And although you're seeing it, you will be seeing it within the context of the MS, there are quite a number of courses also in the architecture degree itself that are engaging with that work, with those capacities. We have a Master of Urban Design degree that has been longstanding, many decades. Its underlying thematic is Detroit and the world. This is this year's cohort of urban design students in Queens, New York, in front of the globe, sort of representing the work that they do. They did a project last semester in which they were working both in Queens and in Detroit. And then there are more global opportunities moving forward. And those of you who are here to explore that degree, Maria Arquero, the director of that degree, will be spending more time with you speaking about it. Of course, we also have the Digital Master of Science in Digital and Material Technologies. This is our cohort of students and faculty and our dean who were in Mexico City at this year's Arcadia Conference, which you'll also see Kathy Velikov, who some of you met last night at Liberty Research Annex, who is, as Jonathan mentioned, the current president of Arcadia. We send the entire MS and DMT class to the Arcadia Conference every year as part of the curriculum. Why University of Michigan? Well, I know that Jonathan, I think, provided the best understanding of why we are an amazing place. But I also want to recall for most of you the opportunities just within the relationships between the architecture degree and the many opportunities for dual degrees that we also have available with urban design, digital material technologies, but also the MBA, the law degree, an MS in environment sustainability, landscape architecture, public health, et cetera, et cetera. And I know that there are a small number of you who are considering us because of those dual degree opportunities. Here within the college, we also have available three graduate certificates in real estate development, healthy cities, and in urban informatics. So if you're interested in any of those, do speak with me or another person. We'll put you in touch with the right people, if that isn't the right person, to talk further about those other kinds of opportunities. We are a college of architecture and urban and regional planning, and I really want to give a shout out to our colleagues in urban and regional planning. This is a studio in Sao Paulo, Sao Leopoldo, Brazil, actually, from last year that was taught in conjunction. It was actually a joint studio between the Masters of Urban Design and the Masters of Science in Urban and Regional Planning. We're particularly proud of this studio because it's won really a number of awards, both in architecture, in urban design, and in urban and regional planning, and it really helps to understand the kind of potential for integration of that here. I mentioned already that many of our proposition studios and some of our thesis studios traveled over the course of the studio itself. But we also have a vast array of opportunities for travel in our spring half term in May and June, typically 5 to 7 a year, that go from everywhere in Asia to everywhere in Europe to occasionally India to China, not as recently, but there have been quite a number to various locations in Africa, Latin America, and so on. These are offered up every year by faculty who lead a group of students for 3 to 4 weeks in a different location under the umbrella of a different kind of research project. And then you will get the opportunity to experience just a small piece of our incredibly robust lecture and symposium schedule here. These are just the posters for this past fall, winter, who brought, again, just this past year, Neri Oxman to us from the MIT Media Lab. Neri Oxman's lecture was so large and so popular that it had to take place in Hill Auditorium, which is pretty much the largest venue we have at the University of Michigan. Sir David Ajay was also just here with us. That was a joint lecture with the Stam School of Art and Design. That took place in the Michigan Theater in downtown Ann Arbor. The vast majority of our lectures are here. Just this week, an overflow crowd for Sue Fujimoto in this space, and then we also have many lectures in our auditorium. People like A.L. Weitzman, who was visiting with us this past fall, Anna Louis and Mimi Zeiger, the most recent curators of the Venice Biennale, WeWork, who members of the team of WeWork in New York, coming to talk to us about the future of office space planning, a panel that took place just here, and a workshop called Architecture Camp that took place a couple of weeks ago, led by Laurel Broughton and Andres Haka. So there really are, the framework of our curriculum is really quite broad. We also do some smaller kinds of activities here in which we get to have more intimate conversations about the work and that we do. Celebrations of architecture student research through an exhibition, a grant that we run every year, and an exhibition that they put forward. This was a Nat Noon event in which they spoke about their work. Craig Dickers came to lecture here, but he also did a Nat Noon activity and conversation with us here as well. And then as our number of our faculty who were editors of the book Possible Mediums did a book launch here just, I think, a week or two ago that John McMurrow led a conversation around. So very large, from very large to much more intimate. Usually one symposium a semester, Shaping Future Cities, which took place this fall. Another, actually there are kind of two this semester, but one that's upcoming in early Michigan is part of a series of activities of the course of the year called Living a Digital Life, being led by our faculty here. I cannot say enough about our incredible faculty. You'll get to meet quite a number of them over the course of the day through, through presentations in just a moment, through interactions at lunch and around studio and roundtables and so on. But as Jonathan mentioned, I think more than a dozen Architectural League Prize winners over the course of a couple of actually relatively recent history. Craig Wilkins, the National Design Award winner just this past year, finalist for the Young Architects Award, multiple R&D winners, and several American Academy in Rome prize winners. Awards for our students, in addition to what we're able to provide with merit and financial aid assistance, there's a very robust scholarship, fellowship, and awards opportunities here at Talman College. Just the past couple of days, we've had jurors from the AIA and from our Alumni Council reviewing and awarding prizes to student work up in the exhibition. Our students are also eligible for quite a number of national awards throughout that we compete with other schools around the country. I can't say enough about our career and networking capacities. We have two full-time career services staff members. We have the largest alumni group in the country of any architecture school living. And in addition to our own very generous alums, we have schools, offices around the country and actually globally who participate with us in our career fair, which takes place, just took place actually I think last week, and also who host our students at spring break externships. Over 200 of our students pass over the opportunity to go to Florida during spring break and instead travel around the country to spend a week in offices. Again, some of them are alumni, others just want access to our incredible students. I think these are actually images from last year, some with urban planning, but as I said, over 200 students travel around to meet with folks in offices around the country. With that, I have not actually exhausted all the things I think are so fabulous about our curriculum and our opportunities here. Therefore, I will be around all day long and ask that should you have any questions, please approach me, ask them. If I can't provide an answer, I will find someone who can. But right now, I'm going to introduce three of our faculty who are going to tell you a little bit about themselves and about their work, because they are going to be talking about themselves. I'm not going to give their very robust histories, except to mention that Craig Borum, FAIA, is a practitioner with work globally. Matias Del Campo, associate professor of architecture, also with a global practice, but he's also a representative, I'd like to think, of both architecture and the master of science in digital and material technology. So I think for those folks looking at us, they'll be very interested in his work. And Anya Sirota, an associate professor of architecture, who again teaches, in this case, both in architecture and in urban design. So with that, I will give it over to them.
Hi, welcome everybody. I'm Craig Borum. I'm a professor here, and that's a little bit loud. I teach in the design studios, in particular in the sequence that Sharon outlined. I teach in the proposition studio this semester, and then in each fall I've been teaching in the system studio, the group that focuses on housing and primarily focused in Detroit. I have a kind of unique situation within that group. I co-teach with Claudia Vigor, and we are, in last year and in this coming year, we have been not working in Detroit, but last year we worked with Tianjin University and looked at high-density housing and the problems of urban renewal in China. The studio was based in Tianjin. We did a week-long workshop and then visited to Beijing as well. This year we're doing a similar setup, also with Tianjin University, but folding in University of Osaka and the University of Aachen in Germany, and doing a workshop on new equitable models of workers' housing in Osaka. So it'll be a kind of exciting kind of a moment where the students, we usually have about 24, we take a trip, we go for about 10 days. We'll be in this year touring both based in Osaka for the workshop, but also touring other cities and looking at housing. I also teach in the construction sequence. I coordinate the construction course. It's a course that's really about the materials and methods of architecture. We look at both traditional methods of construction, but also delving into more advanced problems that are facing the industry today, and specifically developments in building enclosure systems and material assemblies. And those two courses, for me, form a kind of nucleus of things that are enabling me to focus on things that I'm dealing with in my practice. My practice is Ply Plus, and I'm in partnership with another faculty member, Associate Professor Jen McGray, who you'll meet later today. She'll be at the lunch, and I think joining in on the roundtable conversations this afternoon. My class started about an hour ago, and I run all the way through today, so some of you will be shadowing with me in the studio. But our practice, as Sharon mentioned, we both are, we're based here in Ann Arbor. We're a small practice of about 10 people. We have work primarily in Southeast Michigan and Detroit, Ann Arbor. We're working on the Museum of Contemporary Art in Detroit right now. We also have projects at various locations and at various scales in China that we've been developing. We just this year completed a first pretty large, about a 45,000 square foot kind of retreat slash hotel in the Yellow Mountains of China. And today I'm just going to show one project, a local project that we finished also this fall, a small chapel. And through that, talk about some of the things that have been both we've been confronting in practice, and those things have been helping me think through ways of addressing new questions in both the studios and seminars I teach. So this is a small chapel. It's about 30 minutes away in the city of Livonia. It's an addition to an existing hospital. It's a hospital that was founded in the 1930s by a group of Felician nuns who founded the hospital right next to a GM plant. And the hospital's kind of origins came after a kind of massive fire and a kind of incredible crisis of injuries and problems that emerged out of the kind of the factory there. The chapel is an interesting one. It's a Catholic hospital. Again, it's run by Catholics, and so the primary space is a Catholic kind of a meditation chapel. They do have one mass a day, but it's a pretty enlightened hospital. They also have an enlightened organization. As part of it, we also had a space dedicated for Muslim prayer, including spaces that satisfied the rites of ablution, the kind of washing and preparation prior to prayer and cleansing. And a space that was geared toward non-Christian, non-Abrahamic faiths for meditation and kind of relationship. And the project for us is its geometry is a bit distorted and complex. Some of it is a result of dealing with various unseen conditions on site. There's a very large foundation system just to the right that the building is kind of leaning out of the way of. And then there was a kind of relationship between this being both not only the Catholic spiritual center, but also with the other faiths involved. There was a kind of idea that they wanted to put the cross right at the kind of the traditional point on the chapel, but we argued that with it representing so many groups, we could possibly just kind of lean the chapel to the side and borrow the cross that was existing on the building behind us. And so there's a kind of collapse that happens within that space. And we then started to work the geometries to not let it feel like separate spaces, but actually a kind of unified whole. And so the undulation of the walls and the curvature are a kind of way of producing a kind of singular figured body of the architecture. And then using the brick to begin to accentuate the kind of moments of transition within that. So the plan, which you can see the kind of site that we were given is kind of pinched between a whole series of things, a kind of emergency center drop-off with a kind of underground system that we're leaning out of the way of, which allowed us to kind of free ourselves in relationship to the cross on the wall up above, and then this strange kind of triangular wing, which was the previous chapel, which was being abandoned by the hospital. For us, we began looking at the kind of various faiths that we were beginning to accommodate and thinking about the kind of typological structures of how those groups gather. And with the Catholic mass and organization of the space, it's really about a kind of axial procession of in and out with both the Eucharist and the gospel. And so there's an axial relationship that anchors the altar and the entry to that chapel and produces a kind of long linear space. With the Muslim space, it's all about facing Mecca, which was in relationship to our plan, about 53.6 degrees off to one angle. And so how to reconcile the kind of relationship of those geometries within a Midwest context where north and south is kind of primary and establishes the kind of overarching geometry of the region and the hospital itself, which sits in that within the road network. And then orienting a space again at a kind of a different angle, but also it's about a kind of linear organization. It's about spreading wide rather than a kind of linear vector toward the altar. In this case, it's more about stretching out to face everyone equally in relationship to Mecca. And then with the meditation space, we were thinking about its relationship to nature, about using a small courtyard and a small gathering space that would allow a kind of figure to emerge that kind of tied those pieces all together. And then we developed various aspects within those. The altar, a small detail showing a kind of fragment of the altar that we designed and had fabricated. The exterior, which is the iron spot brick, a kind of very dark, iridescent brick quality. As soon as you slip into the courtyard, it's lined with a green glazed brick. And then the trappings of the kind of surfaces that reorient the interior of the Muslim prayer space to Mecca are developed out of a multi-layered metal screen that that we designed and fabricated that played off of the geometric ornamentation and the lack of figuration within traditional Islamic architecture. Within the Catholic chapel, which I'll probably focus the rest of the attention on, and the exterior, and just to give you just a sense of orientation, the section is cut basically through that processional axis to the altar. And one of the things that we were trying to do was set up a kind of sequence of spaces and a kind of a lifting of space as you moved along that axis. So the ceiling begins to rise in relationship to the direction that you're headed. The other thing about the Catholic chapel, which for us was kind of interesting, and I should say we're not, Jen and I, neither of us are, neither of us practice any specific religion, and so there was a lot of research for us that went into understanding the hierarchies of questions and the hierarchies of space and elements that the chapel had to accommodate. And one of the things that we began to realize through all of this is that the relationship between prayer and in the space of this is tends to be focused on particular elements that trigger certain kinds of narratives or stories. For instance, the Stations of the Cross, the altar, the tabernacle, the cross itself. And within a single volume of space, we struggled with how to articulate a kind of balance between all of those. And so what we started to do was began to sculpt the walls in ways that produced small alcoves or niches or almost side chapels for each of those elements that then was partially reflected in the surfacing and shaping of the walls. So in this case, you're seeing the wall of the 14 Stations of the Cross. Each is a small sculptural element that's placed on the wall, but each one is placed within a small tapering scalloped niche that that lines one surface of the wall and almost begins to produce the effect of a kind of draped fabric that lines that surface. The ceiling of the space, and again, the kind of on the right, you're seeing that axial approach through the door straight to the altar ahead. But within the nature of it being a chapel and not a church, there is a different emphasis on the altar and an equivalent emphasis on the tabernacle, which is where the Eucharist is held. There's only one Mass a day. It's at sunrise, but for the chapel is actually open 24 hours a day for anyone who, in a moment of crisis and a need to reflect or kind of have a quiet space with a loved one who might be ill upstairs in the hospital. It's a place of kind of refuge and retreat. And there's a lot of focus, again, on the tabernacle, which is the kind of small vertical piece in the corner. I think I actually have one in here, which is right here. And this is where for the Catholic faith, the Eucharist is kept, the actual, for them, the body and blood of Christ. And so what we tried to do in terms of shaping the ceiling, having it lift toward the kind of direction of procession, but we also produced a kind of tension within that roof or the ceiling by producing a kind of cross axial relationship that drew your attention here, while the kind of ground and the lower level of the chapel was focused very axially and symmetrically on the altar. These are just some of the models that we were producing, both to kind of resolve ourselves how the geometry was working, because it was quite particular in terms of getting two vaults that are basically ruled surfaces and alignment and the kind of relationship that we wanted, where the intersection becomes that kind of perfect kind of chevron or crease that aligns and gives you a kind of orientation. And then the drape, again, almost fabric-like, of being inside almost a tent-like space, but also thinking about kind of inversions of other kinds of traditional architecture that we had been looking at in relationship to, let's say, Baroque volumetric space. This is the entry, an 8-foot pivoting door that's asymmetrically positioned for 3 foot on one side and 5 on the other. That we had a couple of our alumni help us with fabrication on that. Some of the diagrams and drawings of the ceiling. The ceiling is cut to a window that faces due east. So again, the Mass is at sunrise every day, and so that window gets flooded with light right across the altar and against the crucifix. So part of what we were doing is trying to modulate and think about the relationship of those specific elements and then how the architecture itself became a kind of material to sculpt and accentuate and produce various kinds of effects that highlighted each of those elements. Again, the door was designed in a way to reflect the kind of architecture that was happening in the interior, with the slats of the ceiling translating now into the vertical pattern of the door, pivoting along the kind of axis of the embedded cross within it. The altar, the tabernacle stand, and the ambo, or the lectern, were all carved out of single pieces of stone with a group out of Madison, Wisconsin, Quarra Stone Fabrication. And we basically used our digital models directly with them. There was no really exchange of drawings except for kind of a couple of drawings that were produced simply to sign off on the basic dimensions and geometry. But we went back and forth between them with our modeling. They're using KUKA robots just like downstairs. In fact, three of our graduates are working at Quora now, assisting them with the fabrication processes of the company. But carved the altarpiece. This is it upside down. This is it kind of in process, and a rendering, a small kind of image of our model, and the kind of final piece, and a detail of that, which its geometry is actually it picks up on the themes of the chapel itself in terms of its exterior, of transitions that go from right angles to curves, essentially a set of embedded cones that begin to produce a kind of dynamism across the space. One of the for us was a kind of exciting process for us in moving through, and this is where some of the work that I do also in seminars and in the construction course starts to play a kind of interesting role, both feeding our practice and our practice feeding what I do as in the studio and in the seminars, is working on, for instance, an element like this, a corner, a major corner, which is kind of just on the other side of where the tabernacle is, that highest point of the interior, that transitions from a right angle at the bottom to about an 8-foot radius at the top, and working through a kind of a very simple, in our minds, kind of way of laying the brick, where as the brick starts to go around the corner, the angle that the brick is following the curvature of the larger geometry, it kind of lags behind, and so it begins to produce a staggering, and then the opposite course does it in the exact opposite direction. So it's like each course is kind of moving in relationship to each other and produces a kind of woven effect, but also a kind of subtle distortion for a chapel, which is primarily interior. There's only 6 windows in the whole space, one right behind the altar, a set that face a future garden that's being planned for here, and then the east window. So part of our challenge was how to kind of sculpt the exterior in ways that both called attention to it, but also did it in subtle ways. And so the selection of the iridescent brick was also part of the kind of this decision-making process, where there's no point where you don't see this facade in multiple angles, and the way that it picks up light from the reflectivity of the sky to even the green of the grass to occasionally a kind of redness that comes from the brick itself was exciting. See a detail of it there. And part of what we were really engaging in with this was a kind of rethinking of our own workflows in terms of how we were producing drawings. The traditional hard copy paper sets of drawings and specifications that we handle versus working directly with our digital files and models. In this case, this is Mike Piazza, the superintendent of the Masons. We basically produced a digital model for him with every layer of brick as a separate, every course of brick as a separate layer. And and all the Masons had iPads on site, and they're simply using our model as the guide with no other drawings present. And then devising different ways of beginning to organize the laying of the brick from typically they'll run horizontal strings to make sure that they're getting level lines with the brick. These guys are really good. They weren't so concerned about that because they do this all the time. And so they began to reorient their strings into vertical axes in order to begin to locate the points where each of the brick were to hit. And so the kind of relationship of how the wall began to grow out of the ground was a really remarkable one, because we were seeing what felt like to us like our own, like a, it was like a three-dimensional drawing in space with the strings being pulled out, and you could really begin to visualize both what we were drawing and the way that we were working on the project in the computer, and the way that they were beginning to reconcile the kind of difficulties of geometry and the speed of construction. And doing everything that they can to facilitate their own work so they're not having to redo it, and smoothing out that process. And from this, just as a kind of small part, but there's quite a number of moments like this within the project, I've started a new seminar this year called Workflows, where we're beginning to engage and look directly at these kinds of processes. A couple of the images of the exterior. That's the east window that grabs the kind of sunrise light and washes the altar. You can see that every place where we have a kind of exterior curvature on the in the architecture, the brick is following the same logic of a kind of delayed normalization back to the surface as it moves across. You can see another detail there. A couple of more. And then one final kind of moment, which also came out of some research that Jen and I had been doing with Guardian Glass, a global glass manufacturing plant that's headquartered here, but producing probably one of the world's largest producers of glass. We were studying a particular type of glass that they were developing, and we were working on with them a set of recipes for different coatings on the glass that filtered different wavelengths of light while allowing the glass to remain primarily transparent, but producing ultimately for us kind of as part of, like, we were looking at it in relationship with the grant toward greenhouses and the relationship between wavelengths of light and the growth of plants, but realizing as well that it was an opportunity to rethink the relationship of a stained glass window within the chapel. And so the window, the one south-facing window, which sits right near the tabernacle, is lined with various planes of two different recipes of glass that filtering two different wavelengths of light, and then calibrating those to the angles of the sun so that there's a kind of constant transformation of the color and quality of light within the chapel that gets caught right in this corner, again, where we sculpted the geometry of the walls. You can see a kind of arcing geometry behind, and then another arc, which is basically making the space of the altar, and you can see it inscribed in the floor. But you see how that light just gets caught right in that, the colored light gets caught within that space, and a kind of nice shadow line begins to emerge across in terms of the way we're beginning to blanket the effect of that space. Again, I'll be around most of the day. I'll be with my students all day, so some of you will see me up in the up on the third floor. I think a few of you are shadowing with me this afternoon, but feel free to stop and say hi and take a look at what we're up to. So thank you.
Hello, everyone. It's a hard act to follow up on this very, very detailed presentation of a project. It's a beautiful project by Craig. Let me just quickly see. There I am. All right. Hi, everyone. My name is Matthias Del Campo. I'm an associate professor of architecture here in the college. I had the pleasure to meet some of you already yesterday in the Liberty Annex. Today, there's plenty of other opportunities, so after this lecture, if you have any questions, we can have lunch together. I think I'm going to be on a table with you in the afternoon. There will be some shadowing of my studio with you guys. And afterwards, I think we're going to see together the student show. So plenty of opportunities to talk. I primarily teach here in the college thesis studio, but also AR591, Generative Design Computing. And I teach in the MSDMT program, 703 virtual engagement. So in fact, my expertise is certainly in the area of computational design, the combination to fabrication, but also how to transform specific context and concepts and theories into, let's say, building projects. So today I'm going to show you a couple of things that I've been doing together with my partner Sander Manninger at SPAN. That's the name of our practice. Sander Manninger is also an assistant professor of practice here at the college. And we both believe in the idea, I think Craig mentioned this also briefly, of the cross-pollination between the practice and what we do in the college. Some ideas come from both directions. So first of all, I would like to show a little bit about my, let's say, my origins. Yeah. So I was born in Chile. I was raised in Austria, in Vienna. I grew up in Vienna. And it took me a long time to understand how much actually that city has influenced my ideas about architecture and how profoundly I was influenced by what I saw on a daily basis. So this, for example, is the Rose Window of St. Stephen's in Vienna, which I basically passed every day on my way to college. But it took me, I think, decades to figure out how beautiful it actually is. Also in terms of what it does with geometry. And that's one of the areas of expertise in my office is the idea of how to transform problems of geometry into built reality or projects. This is another example from St. Stephen's, basically trying to emulate natural behavior through non-organic material, yeah? Stone in this case, or Baroque forms, Baroque shapes, ideas about agglomerations, aggregations of matter, expressing specific ideas. So in this case, it's basically a cloud that is populated by putties and crosses and a lot of things. It's basically very Baroque in its nature, but also I'm interested in how that geometry actually entails and tells a specific story. On the other end, so if you have on the one side this whole Baroque and very articulated and very rich tradition, you have also a tradition of, let's say, proto-modern architects, like Otto Wagner in this case. This is one of the earliest examples of the use of aluminum in architecture, for example. A very, minimalized form of architecture. Or another one, of course, being Adolf Loos, who despised ornament because of his arguments of how it takes away the lifetime of people just carving away ornaments. I'm very suspicious about Loos, and I resist actually his idea a lot. In that extent that today's environment actually allows us to do that without his argument. So some of those arguments that were created in the modern beginnings are not valid anymore, and we're trying to understand how we can operate in our contemporary age with new ideas. In that line of resisting heroes is also Hans Holland, who was one of my teachers. This example I like very much because he basically takes that rigid modern grid and starts to deform it and distort it and change it and break it up. And through that, actually starts to generate a novel language of architecture. I apologize for the theory part of this here, but I think it's important to understand actually where some of the things come from that we do in our practice. So I'm pretty much fascinated with Gottfried Semper, 19th century architect, philosopher, theorist who wrote one book called Der Stil, I think in English it's called Style, where he speculated about the origins of architecture. Like, why do we do walls? Why do we use textiles? How do we use them? Why do we represent textiles in stone, for example, in antiquity? And although a lot of the things that are present in this book are maybe outdated, some of those are almost timeless in the way how you can apply them also when you're using computational design ideas. Textiles, formations, seams, softness. So there's a lot of things that you can still apply and use. His idea of the primordial hut, yeah? Basically just a couple of sticks and textiles. And of course, other prototypical architectural ideas, like nine square grid and other things. So how do we transform all this sort of historic baggage, yeah, into something contemporary? Because the last thing I want to do is imitate history. Yeah? It's not about copying history, it's just, maybe I would say it's learning about history and then positioning that in a 21st century environment. So I do not negate history, I try to get the best out of it. So one of those Baroque elements that we found out about are space-filling polyhedra. Space-filling polyhedra, if you think about that, they're basically pieces of geometry that you can seamlessly connect to each other to create, let's say, a wall. Like the most simple one we know as architects are bricks. Basically, that's a space-filling polyhedron. But Sandra and I have been looking into other examples of that and how we can put them together into bodies that that constitute an architectural piece. Most recently, we did that No, that's not so recent. That's another example of using tiling geometries, which was an exhibition design we did, where we used hexagons basically to put them together. Or another one is this one here, where we used so-called chiral tessellation. So there's always this sort of geometric background that we use to play around with and construct things out. So this is basically the basics of the chiral tessellation. But you can do this also in space with pieces like this. So instead of just having a couple of pieces coming together, in this case, we use over 3,000 of these space-filling polyhedra to put this hut together. Maybe our very simple way of expressing an idea of the primitive hut. There's no insulation here or anything, but the idea is also how can I just use one geometry and create something articulated out of it. So in this case, for example, these are all the same geometry at the end of the day. It's like bricks, just an alternative idea of bricks. But through a variety of perforations, we can get to this very highly articulated complex body. It's a bit too bright in here, actually, to see those things clearly. Sorry for that. This was the plans and sections of assembly. And then another one, talking about corners, I actually really enjoyed Craig's explanation of his corner because it actually shows again how architects are still dealing with the problem of the corner. And in our case, we also were speculating about the idea of the corner. And, like turning a face has been always a problem. Yeah? But how do you deal with that in a contemporary context? How do you, when you have machines that can fabricate the things, when you have computational tools that give you a specific amount of articulation. So we played around with this for a concept design for a pop-up store in Shanghai. On the side note, of course, I mean, I'm Viennese, so I use gold. Yeah, that's very important. And the idea of how to, for example, just by randomly distributing points, you can actually start playing around with the idea of the corner. We have been doing some remodelings. This was also in Shanghai. This is the Shanghai Institute of Visual Arts. That's actually the school of fashion that we actually remodeled for them. We tried to keep it very simple. I mean, you have to imagine this space was cluttered with walls and stuff and things, and we just cleaned out everything, made it very simple, just one floor and an articulated ceiling, and everything else happens in between those two, basically this sandwich of space. The reception desk, one, this is the separation wall to the meeting room. That was on the ground floor, the exhibition space. So I explained at the beginning that a lot of our fascination is about geometry and how to use that. And we actually always pick up one specific geometrical problem and work through that almost on several years. So one part was about topological surfaces. So these examples of exhibition spaces that you saw, these pods, had a lot to do with topological surfaces. And then we started exploring recursion. Recursion, if you remember that rose window at the beginning, do I have that again? No. If you remember that rose window at the beginning, the geometry of that was basically just circles in circles in circles. So it's actually repeating one geometry, one simple geometry, and by doing it over and over again, it starts to create complexity. Later on, we started to look into recursion, which is a similar problem. You have one algorithm, and then by repeating that algorithm over and over again, you start to create complex behavior. And the person who came up with the concept of the fractal, which is one of the ideas of recursion, is Benoit Mandelbrot, this gentleman here. He developed a formula in the early 70s. It actually influenced a lot, funny enough. Well, not funny enough, but it influenced actually Hollywood a lot because the creation of synthetic landscapes in 3D for animation, for example, was extremely complicated before he came up with the formulas of fractal behavior. And that actually just generated, it became this sort of generative idea of landscapes. Here it is again, what I mentioned before, the circles and circles and circles. In our response to this idea of the rose window, we tried to do something similar and just repeating one specific circular algorithm, and we got this here. So you see that even by just comparing a similar geometric idea, you can come up with something which doesn't look like it is Gothic or Baroque or anything, but resembles in its qualities what it was. And around the time when we started doing this, we also had the luck to be invited to do this exhibition here of our work. in the MAC in Vienna. The MAC is very specific in terms of what it's asking from architects for exhibitions. So they say the last thing we want is a retrospective of your work. We don't want plans and sections on the walls. We don't want like a bunch of models and then say like these years. That's not our interest. We want you to create a specific environment. Express basically an idea that you have about architecture with an installation instead of showing like a bunch of things. So we came up with this ceiling with an example of that recursive geometry things we were exploring. This was also on show there, like a prototypical idea of how to use that sort of complexity and recursion within an urban context. We have been working on this for years. Like, this is a more recent example called Blocks. It was published in the AD, in AD Architectural Design. Again, thinking through prototypical architectural problems like joints, mullions, columns, differences, co-niches, vaults, and so on. So they're all present somehow in those images, although they're not a specific project. We call these things, Sandra Manning and I call these abstract machines. These are basically proto ideas of projects. So these are like the very beginning of something that could become a project at some point. It's not a specific project in that it has no function, no plans, no sections, nothing of that. It's just the beginning of an abstract possibility that can convert at one point into an architectural project. For example, in this case, where those ideas were then picked up for the design of a private bar in Shanghai, basically picking up on those possibilities that this abstract machine gives us and then building through those. And then we had one thing was problematic about how to transform those images into something three-dimensional, because they start in 2D, and how do you get them in 3D? The most simple one is, of course, making a tomographic mapping of those spaces. This was actually an exhibition of ours in Shanghai in the Fab Union Gallery. We also showed the particle hut again there. And this is the first image, by the way. This is the Expo Pavilion that we did for Austria in 2010 in China. So, and all this work finally paid off. Last weekend, I was in Beijing and signed a contract to build a school. And that's actually one image of that school design. So you see that several years of research finally paid off in that it's becoming really a building. Yeah, and I'm looking forward to build this project starting fall. We do a lot of exhibitions. I think it's important for us. We do not differentiate between, let's say, the design of a chair or a building or an exhibition. These are all methods of expression for architecture in one way or the other. It can be conceptual, it can be built. I don't care too much, really. I think that it's always better just to find a method of how to express your thoughts as an architect. And these are not necessarily just buildings. In this case, for example, the exhibition in the MAC in Los Angeles gave us the opportunity to speculate about one thing we've been playing around with, which is augmented reality and how to use augmented reality in architecture. So you see that person here in front of the image holding their phone up. They're not doing they're not photographing the thing. They're basically holding it up because it had an app that produced three-dimensional columns in front of that image. And the whole idea was basically that this exhibition was in a Rudolf Schindler house, and Schindler actually didn't really like columns, and we made this play on putting a lot of columns in his space, of course virtual, but still there's a lot of columns, and you can find them in 3D in front of that image. And also last year, another exhibition together with François Roche and who else was there? Roland Snooks and Ezio Placetti, called Digital Disobediences. This is kind of the weird part when I'm so digital in my work and I do an exhibition like that. But in fact, it was very digital in the sense that it started to question how we're using digital tools today. So trying to understand that it has become a normality in architectural production, and what does a specific project differentiate from, let's say, the common use of digital tools? Some signatures. And along these lines, one project that I'm really happy to work on right now is the so-called Robot Garden. It's a profoundly post-human project in the sense that it's not a garden for humans, it's a garden for robots. And how does that work? There's like this whole problem of, on the one side, we have to understand that, we are slowly basically starting to share expertise, but also agency with other agents, meaning we are not on the top of the design agenda anymore. There's like a variety of other things also influencing our design agendas, and among them also artificial intelligence. And we have been playing around with ideas of style transfer in, with artificial intelligence. Basically, it means programming neural networks to understand features and applying them to other imagery. For example, I trained an AI to understand the features of these high-rises in Hong Kong, this repetitiveness, the windows, the mullions, everything, yeah? And then combine that with, let's say, the interior of a Baroque church in Germany and see what happens if I combine these two ideas together, what does it generate? You get things like this. Yeah? So basically, a neural network is able to understand or to read or hallucinate, actually, that's the correct word, to hallucinate features that you program or teach him in other images. Right now, like Google Dream, you all know Deep Dream from Google, right? Basically, that's the same thing. In that we used basically to do this project here. This is the robot garden. This is supposed to be to get built now 5 minutes from here in the new robotics building in front of it. And the reason why it's not for humans and for robots is that this is basically the testing ground for their robots. So they build 4-pad and 6-pad robots, 2-pad robots, and they wanted to have some area with a lot of different features to test the robots and see how they walk around there. So this is primarily done for robots and not for humans. Even the fountain in there is not really for humans. It's there because they needed a water feature. So that robots, what happens if robots walk through water, or what if it's an iced surface? So there's like a lot of things here that were primarily done for robots. But I already heard that humans are going to misuse it because they said that the steps are really great for sitting out in summer and having lunch. So, okay. Oh, I want to mention also at the end that last year's thesis studio that I did together with Sandra Manninger actually won the AIA Architect Studio Prize. I don't know if Sharon mentioned that already. Okay. That was actually a great achievement for the studio. This was a studio that where we traveled to Switzerland, to CERN. It was done in collaboration with CERN in Switzerland, speculating about their new Large Hadron Collider that they're going to build, the Future Circular Collider, which is about 47 miles long, so it's an enormous ring, and it was featured in the cover of Architect magazine. And very proud of the students that made this possible. This was an amazing studio. As I said, I primarily teach a thesis studio, and this year, for example, we traveled to Tokyo. We are speculating about artificial intelligence and architecture in the studio a lot, like what does it mean, how do we use it? And also doing that, we collaborate with the robotics department. We're having experts coming over from their AI department to teach our students really how to program CycleGANs and how they can use it in their designs. So just a couple of images of that studio from last year. Yes, and that's it. Thank you very much for listening. You have a lot of chances to talk to me later, so back to you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Anya Sirota, and I'm an associate professor here at Taubman College. I teach in the graduate program of architecture as well as urban design. And you've been very strong. You have to admit that architects love to talk about their work, and I'm the third in this parade of confessionals. So I appreciate your attention. If I can tell you a little bit about my background and about myself, I'm one of those types of architects that came to it very late in life. So I'm the equivalent of what would be like a 3G, where I did something completely different for a good decade. I focused on film and documentary production, and then suddenly had an awakening in my 30s, so which is really fabulous. It means that I'm still a young architect. But I wanted to tell you a little bit about the motivations behind a practice that I lead that's primarily focused in Detroit, that's based in Detroit, and that looks at opportunities for architecture to make social impact in the built environment and to peel architecture away from its relationship to capital, from its normal relationships between client and architect, and see how architecture can participate in public discourse can reevaluate the way we treat urban environments and reevaluate the way that we engage the political environment in which we live. So this is an image of one of the projects that I was involved in a couple of years ago, where we created an installation on the roof of the Packard Automotive Plant that tried to imagine an alternate future for the Packard. And as you can see, it's sort of right in the middle of the melee of the post-industrial environment, and it just creates a space for discussion, for interconnectivity, for human experience by clearing some of the debris of the post-industrial roof and beginning to build an alternate reality right on that landscape. So one of the main questions that we've been asking ourselves over the course of the last few years is, what can architecture do in complex urban environments where some of the capital has been drained from the capacity of architecture to build and make typical impact? And we've realized that one of the things that we can do as architects is work in community and sort of even redefine what community is as something that's geographically bound, as a group of people living in a particular environment, but also as an ephemeral opportunity, as a community that can be built through experience, through environments that are ephemeral, temporary. And it's also an ideological community that we work with. We find complicity, we find friends, we find like-minded individuals that are globally engaged and interested in working in local scenarios. We found also that architecture can set the stage. It can create environments in which cultural production can participate in public discourse and can be staged in order to tell the story of communities, people that don't normally find voice in the architectural scenography. As architects, we also like to work on making something out of nothing. This is a research project that we launched with Meredith Miller at Taubman College a few years back that looked at ways that architecture can use sort of the particulates, the environment, the inexpensive things like cold weather and debris that's in our air to create alternate ways of treating surfaces in architectural scenographies. So we were trying to figure out if we could use electrical impulses to literally train frost into acting in a particular way in this Michigan environment that's very cold. And we were very excited when we did learn that we were able to train frost, and this is a very early experiment of this phenomenon, but you can create impulses on the surface of an architecture and start to allow frost to act in a particular way. It's very early in its development. It still can sort of electrocute small birds, so it's not in use just yet. We also understood that we can materialize ontologies, and this is the sort of winks at my background in semiology, but this idea that we don't necessarily need to create direct neo-pomo citation, but we can create a sentiment that something was there and that there's a relationship between an audience and an object that makes people think that something is familiar or that it recounts a story of place and context. This is a scenography, a stage set that we built at the Oakland Avenue Urban Farm, which is a farm in Detroit, that took parts of stages that were in process of disappearing due to blight remediation, coupled them, sort of hybridized them into a new form, but cited the colors and shapes of the original. And so these objects that we build, we work very closely with local artists. This is so it worked as a kind of stage set for an opera that we staged in Detroit. We also understood that architecture can build institutions. This is a clip-on arch that we created that was a representation of a group of artists in Detroit that were interested in bringing back an arts council in Detroit. One of the first things that's often cut when budgets get scarce is arts funding. And in Detroit, as you might know, there's no arts council representing the myriad of people who operate and practice in Detroit. And so a group of artists was interested in situating themselves as a nomadic arts council. And we designed this arch that was a clip-on to existing urban conditions, existing buildings. And when it clipped onto a building, it, for a very short period of time, became the Arts Council of Detroit. And it would hold quarterly meetings and festivities and other engaged events. We've also been able to think about how architecture can reconsider preservation. How can it tell stories about a particular context or place without, let's say, museumifying or being lamentful about the loss of a place or a scenario, but instead celebrating the cultural sort of significance of place. This is a mothership that we built in the north end of Detroit. It's a DJ booth and urban marker in the north end that reminds us of the history of funk music in Detroit. In this particular neighborhood. I don't know if any of you know Parliament Funkadelic or the extraordinary mothership that used to land, and George Clinton would come out wearing furs and the smoke, and all. We tried to imitate that. We got permission from George Clinton. And so this is the diagram. Ooh. Very stretched out diagram of our project that describes how we communicated with our local partners about the value of building a space capsule in their neighborhood rather than, say, fixing porches or working on rooftops to stabilize the environment. Ignore all of the blurriness. Something extraordinary is happening on the technological field. And so once we built this mothership, we parked it, or we landed it, in a garage called the 1 Mile Garage that we named also. And we let that space be available to musicians for the duration of 4 years, where everyone who was interested in staging their own party, their own performance, used it as a space of experimentation and cultural engagement. So normally there's sound. And this is the extraordinary, you can hear a little sound? There's a hint of sound. The sound is really good because it's Mahogany Jones who's rapping with a group of jazz musicians from Detroit. And the mothership quietly in the background as a signifier. So we also build civic commons. We're working in the North End to create a land trust where the urban farming community and our partners co-own 6 acres of landscape that are partially productive, partially exuberant for parties and cultural events, and partially involved in creating new economic opportunities. And this is the model that lives there. Some of the projects that are on the farm include the store. We like to call it the Little Big Box. We're affectionate about it. But it's a big box that we're converting into a public kitchen and event space that's funded through the housing that's on the top. We're also building something that's called The Landing, and that's a project that transforms a 2-family house into a youth hostel. And as you can see, the kind of representations that we're exploring look at ways that architecture can communicate with a very broad, popular audience to move outside of the limits of our own profession and see how we can engage change in community. Let's see. Oops. So when we launch these projects and when we engage people who live in these environments, we often build prototypes. So even if we look at some of the sections, they involve us designing the details all the way down to the wallpaper. And this is a wallpaper that we developed made out of car parts that's describing the flora and fauna at the Oakland Avenue Urban Farm. We build these constructs so that we prototype the kind of vibe and sensibility of how the architecture might operate. And then we find those same elements in our sections and drawings that people can really understand how architecture might be able to communicate. And another project at the farm is the Red's Jazz Shoeshine Project, where we're looking to transform a historic shoeshine and speakeasy into its original program on the farm. And you can see when we zoom into the speakeasy portion, you'll see the same Mahogany Jones character and the other musicians that we work with. When we launch our projects, we invite the same people who envision producing programming for these new cultural interventions to parties and openings with community members so that people can begin to understand what we mean by programming and what we mean by representation in architecture. Some of the more experimental partners that we have on this project are Onyx Ashanti on the left, who's a self-proclaimed sonic cyborg. So he 3D prints his own instruments, and then they're responsive to his feelings and gestures. And then on the right, Pierre Lambla, a jazz musician who's cooperating with him and sort of helping uplift the value of the tomatoes that are being grown in the backyard. And most recently, we've taken some of these lessons learned from working on small-scale projects in community environments, and we've translated them to a larger-scale project in the Detroit's upcoming cultural district. So we've been participating in a competition for the last year now, which tries to reimagine how we might unify 12 disparate institutions in Detroit around the Detroit Institute of Art and create a cultural district that's inclusive, that imagines how people from all walks of life may participate in that kind of landscape. And so, wow, that's another extraordinary... I think secretly this PowerPoint is trying to adapt to Matthias's aesthetic sensibilities and add a little bit of jazz to the feeling. But this is our diagram of how the cultural district might operate, how it might be controlled, how its responsive systems might be controlled through what we call a DJ booth, a data jockey center, where artists in Detroit who might not be affiliated with the larger institutions might participate in the creation and the transformation of the cultural landscape. So this is the addition that we've proposed for the DIA. This is the back entrance where we've imagined a kind of Afrofuturist Baroque canopy that's the entry condition to the Institute of Art, which is a more classical classicist building, and the interior of that canopy with some of the ornament and programming that's inspired through our partnerships with artists in Detroit. So all that to say is that there are extraordinary opportunities to rethink how architecture operates in fields where typically we haven't seen architects engage without having first some kind of relationship to a client base. But there is an extraordinary opportunity for us to work preemptively, for us to imagine our own relationships to context and place. And that's been a kind of driver for my practice and the work that I've done at Taubman College over the course of the past few years. If you have any questions about all of this, I'm sure you're going to be overwhelmed by information from all sorts of folks, but seek me out. My studio is right up here in the new wing, and I'd be happy to answer your questions. Thanks.